Hello, Akra here, and welcome back to the channel. I'm sure I speak to the experiences of many a Fire Emblem player when I say that there's nothing quite as satisfying as getting a good level up and seeing all the numbers increase. It's the reason why I do 100% rather than 0% or fixed gross LTCs after all. While of course, this is the evergreen appeal of the trainee or villager, with or without aptitude, this can also be the case with a later joining recurring group of units, known as Ests. So today we're going to take a closer look at the archetype. This will include who's been considered part of it and whether they actually qualify, how some of them are valued as units in various amounts of detail, and what does and doesn't work while implementing them. First of all though, we need to define the term. The definition of Est that seems to be broadly used is the following. An Est is a late joining, unpromoted unit that joins with low bases for their join time, note, not necessarily for their level, and typically with high growths. There are a lot of relative terms here, especially when you include different people's definitions of high growths, late joining, and low bases. The question of which units qualify as Ests has been asked many times. I mentioned the trainee slash villager archetype in my introduction, which I've seen around the community to mean a unit that joins often within the first third of the game, with a low starting level and bases and often enhanced growth rates, as a distinction from Ests. This is a distinction that I personally adhere to, and I think perhaps the best way to illustrate this distinction is to answer the question, who are the debated Ests? In a quick search online over the definition of Ests, the following units pop up. Unsurprisingly, with a staggering 6 appearances across FEs 1, 2, 3, 11, 12, and 15, we have the OG Est, youngest of the White Wing Sisters. From Valentia, FEs 2 and 15, we have Jesse on Salica's side and Delphia on Olm's. From FE 4, we have Tulltew, don't at me, it's Irish pronunciation, in Generation 1, and Corpa, or his replacement Charlo in Gen 2. From FE5, Miranda and Sarah. From FE6, Sophia and Zeiss. The very well-known example of Nino from FE7. Amelia and Ewan from FE8. Tormod and Alincia from Path of Radiance. Kerfnaga and a character that you can only get on a repeat playthrough of Radiant Dawn. All of the child units specifically from Awakening. Specifically the Silver Snow iteration of Cyril from Three Houses, and Rosado from Fire Emblem Engage, the most recent entry in the series as of the time of me writing the script. Note that I say debated. I would firmly consider some of these units to be very much not Ests. In my opinion, the most egregious ones are definitely Amelia and Ewan from FE8. This is for several reasons. If we look at their growth totals, Amelia and Ewan are among the lowest of the cast. This means that they don't fit the associated high growths idea of the S archetype, and therefore that any long-term statistical superiority over other units comes purely from the fact that they get to level up more times than other units do. Insofar as late joining goes, Amelia can join you within the first half of the game, and has to do so if you want to recruit her and go on Ephraim's route. While I could understand the argument for Ewan as he joins at chapter 12, which is around 60% of the way in, and it's definitely true that her base stats when she joins really suck, I personally don't consider at or around the halfway point to be an especially late join. It's true that they're unpromoted, but they aren't even tier 1 like the rest of many of these contenders, instead being tier 0, so to speak, which I believe differentiates them. As such, instead of counting them as Ests, I instead consider them to be trainees, which I believe is the common consensus among the Fire Emblem community. While the problems with them are similar, the exploration of trainees as a unit archetype goes beyond the scope of this video. If you're interested though, there is a video that you can check out that does explore them, which is a simultaneous release with a friend of mine, the fabulous Danny Doyle, which you can find a link to in the video description and will be linked at the end of this video as well. I also will not be analysing the child units from Awakening, since I'm not qualified to talk about Awakening Lunatic, and child units as a whole are a whole other can of worms. That brings us to the next question. How are the Ests as units? As I imagine is unsurprising, given the rather unflattering archetype description, late joiner and low bases tend to be slightly damning words, the Ests tend to be considered pretty abysmal units. That brings us onto the title of the video, The Problems with Ests. The main problem with Ests is that it's very difficult for a unit that joins late to really offer many contributions in the form of unique utility that only they can perform. This is especially the case with the idea behind this archetype being that they join with low bases and are usually unpromoted. Any tasks that you need to be done in a more quote-unquote efficient setting are almost invariably going to be covered by earlier joining units, who, even if they have lower growths overall, will likely have gained the requisite stats to solve all the problems the game poses to you by the point in time where the Est in question joins you. A point in time, may I add, where said Est is unlikely to have standout stats or other qualities upon join, which mean that they're able to perform said role without a training arc beforehand. Though this may sound obvious, it's worth noting that it presents a different problem from training a trainee. A trainee takes kills and experience that early joining units want so that they can grow, whereas your trained units or late joiners with a high level and good bases don't care that you're training your Est. While this means that they at least aren't necessarily detrimental to use from a purely experience distribution standpoint, the Est does have to train against stronger enemies who pose more of a threat to them until they get their levels and hopefully stats. Ests being bad, I think, is very much the case for Ests who are in games with good pre-promotes and limited deployment slots. The most dramatic and well-known example of this being Nino being an Est in a game where Pent exists. It certainly doesn't help that in this case, Pent actually joins before Nino does, at the start of Eliwood 24/Hector 26, whereas Nino functionally joins 3 maps later in 26X or 28X due to Battle Before Dawn being a map that one could certainly choose to try and train her on. Firstly, ignoring the case where there are additional benefits to the pre-promote, such as high weapon rank, especially in a weapon type only acquired upon promotion, such as Pent's A staff rank, meaning that he can use warp for free, whereas Nino starts from East Staves as a sage. The boon of extra stats may be overstated. The context of the game may very well mean that any extra stats may not matter anyway, in actual terms, due to the pre-promote already reaching the required one round KO thresholds. Alternatively, the trained Est may not reach said one round KO benchmarks, meaning that both units would require 2 or maybe even more rounds of combat to be able to reliably kill an enemy regardless. Secondly, and I think more interestingly, the bases of a pre-promote are RNG proof. When considering the large number of levels that the Est typically has to gain to catch up to the pre-promote in question, especially if you decide to get them to level 20 before promotion, there is a very real chance that even if the average stat calculations say that your Est should, after much unneeded effort, outpace the pre-promote, this doesn't happen due to stat variance in a number of cases. Once again comparing Nino and Pent, while averages say that they will have the same attack if you get her to 26, there is a 59% chance that this Nino has the same or less attack than base Pent does at 18 magic after you factor in the promotion gain of 1 magic for female sage. A good stat to look at between the two that reflects both of these points is speed. Based on averages, a 26 Nino is meant to be 6 points ahead of base Pent on speed. This is a doubling threshold and a half, which looks great on paper. In addition, she has only around a 1% chance of having the same or lower speed compared to him, based on the binomial distribution. However, the added factor of her 4 con as a sage compared to his 8 means that the difference is only actually 2 speed when a sufficiently heavy tome is being used, such as L5 of its 10 weight. This extra 4 points of speed from con means that there is now a 24% chance of Nino being functionally the same or lower speed than Pent, which still isn't bad. But then there's the question of how much this functional 2 speed average lead matters, which FE7 has a reputation, even on Hector hard mode, of most enemies being incredibly slow, occasional exceptions like the Cog of Destiny Valkyries aside. So Pent's speed, even if it's meant to be worse than Nino's, both still has a real chance of being functionally better in practice, and also already makes him fast enough to double everything that you need him to. And both of the attack and speed comparisons have made the not trivial assumption that we're bringing Nino to 24 promotion, making the outlook for earlier promotion even less optimistic. This is, of course, a core part of Fire Emblem's identity involving RNG growths as a whole. even if we decide to ignore the process of training the Ests to catch up, which, for the record, I don't think we should, we need to acknowledge the possibility that in the end, you may well end up with a unit who's not only inferior to one that you get given right out of the box, but that you've also invested more time and resources into, which is, well, an L. That isn't to say, though, that all Ests are bad, or perhaps more accurately, that they're implemented badly, with its very strong pre-promotes making it such that you almost don't need to use any of the unpromoted scrubs in FE7, debatable Est or not. Nino versus Pent is a very extreme example. So, what makes an Est a good Est? A quality that I personally like in Ests, and also in trainees, is if, when trained, they're able to provide some unique utility for you, even if it still doesn't make them worth training in a more efficient context. As some examples, especially in Gaiden, where she's the only female mage present on Om's side natively, ignoring death warps, Delphia has a nice spell list including the accurate, monster-effective Seraphim and high might spells Aura and Ragnarok, with already relatively high personal attack, which can be leveraged in both magical and physical damage due to female mage gaining sword upon promotion to Priestess. Additionally, equipping the speed ring to her automatically gives her cat speed at 40, gives her 5 extra move, and allows her to recover some lost HP from spellcasting, or if she fails to dodge each turn. This is also true to an extent in the Gaiden remake, Shadows of Valentia, even though Faye also exists and can be made a mage with a fairly decent spell list of her own. I say this as I feel for a blind player, especially one who's new to the series, examining the various areas around Ram Village primed them to make Grey a merc, Tobin an archer, and Cliff a mage. They are therefore inclined to make Faye one of a cleric, Pegasus, knight, or cavalier, rather than another mage, due to the RPG temptation of wanting to quote-unquote balance the party. In FE9, due to the fact that unlike FE10, you aren't able to unequip and equip people's personal skills at will to other units, Tormod's celerity skill does at least give him heals on wheels should you choose to haul him along. This is still in spite of the fact that magic in Tellius isn't very good, and that almost all magical needs either in 100% or 0% LTC can be covered by Sorin and Khalil instead. But it's something, and move is always a good stat to have more of. Also from FE9, Alincia, while joining with a pitiful 9 strength at Clash, the 4th from last chapter of the game, with only D swords and therefore being very far off from the Sonic Sword rank of B to leverage her better 12 magic against enemies generally lower res, is the only flying staffer in the game. This is especially noteworthy as the only other mounted staffer, and therefore only other staffer with innate Kanto, is a promoted Mist, who is still a cavalier, a less flexible movement type than flight. Then she joins with A staves on top of that. I'm not saying that Tellius staves are especially needed, not least because neither FE9 nor FE10 have warp, but having a unit join, even late, with the ability to use basically all the staves in the game for free, is undeniable utility. To a much lesser extent, this is the case with both of the potential cases from FE4. Toltiu is the mother to both Tinny and more importantly Arthur if you aren't running with substitutes, so she does have to actually exist in order for Horsetti or similar to come into existence. Similarly, Charlotte as Corpus substitute joining towards the end of Generation 2, after some shenanigans, is the only way for the player to gain access to a Berserk staff, which could be of use. I stipulate that this is to a lesser extent than with the other examples, because you don't, strictly speaking, need to use the units to see combat, or really do anything other than exist and either get a lover or activate a certain event. Separate, I think, from the definition of a good Est, and rather veering a bit more in potentially actually quote-unquote good unit territory, is a closer look at Zeiss from FE6 and Cyril from Silver Snow. Let's start off with Zeiss, an Est that's actually solid. Zeiss joins as a level 7 unpromoted Wyvern Rider in chapter 16 of an either 22 or 25 chapter game, depending on whether you're on track for the true ending, not including Gaiden chapters, and who is better on hard mode compared to normal mode, thanks to hard mode bonuses meaning that he joins with 19 strength on average, compared to 14, and 15 defense instead of 12. Even his speed sees an improvement from 8 to 11, and due to his high strength and defense bases, early promotion is advised for +2 speed, because he's likely to cap his strength by the time he hits level 10 due to his 60% growth in it. Though speed is definitely a huge issue that he continues to have even with training, due to only having a 35% growth in it. This stat spread functionally makes him something of a hard-hitting armored unit that can fly, and then his low con isn't great for his own speed issues, not least because there are other people who join earlier who want the body ring, like his sister, but it does make him very good at ferrying other people around, even though you have other people around longer who can also rescue drop while flying, like Shana or Thea. So he's not as good as Milady, but he's still perfectly fine. In a situation where you don't have her around for some reason, like a draft or an Iron Man where you've lost her, he does the job fine enough once he arrives. It's kind of weird though, because this makes him a solid late joining unit due to his actual combat stat bases in strength and defense. To me, this feels antithetical to the concept of an S joining late with low bases, so I'm not sure whether he really qualifies under that measure or if I like this method of quote-unquote improving Ests overall. Now let's move on to an implementation that I like better, which is that of Silver Snow Cyril. Let's get this straight. I'm not saying that Silver Snow Cyril is as good as his Azure Moon / Verdant Wind counterpart. He joins in Chapter 12 as opposed to joining for Chapter 5's infamous map without having gained any class masteries or the additional trained proficiency that you'd want of him. The ones specifically lacking are Lantis for Vengeance at C+, and Authority, as he starts at E in the latter, and there are no flying battalions that are E rank. Additionally, he's grown only in Villager, and so has not been able to take advantage of any very minor class growths. However, he isn't complete trash. He joins a point-blank volley at base, and due to starting with B axes, it is very feasible to get him onto a Wyvern within the first month of his join, due to the certification only asking for C flying, and being able to gamble it before then, at a point in time where seals aren't as competitive. Even with subpar bases and weapon ranks, especially due to the way that Free Houses works, there's a lot that a point blank volley Wyvern can do. And then, of course, Vengeance can come online and do its thing as well, meaning that he's still very workable due to the tools that he has at his disposal. I quite like this implementation, as Silver Snow Cyril is a unit that can still be worked with and offers the unique combination of Vengeance and a Brave combat art for doing so, but who also undeniably has bad stats for his join. While, of course, it can be very fairly argued that you only really need one of those tools to be effective as a maddening combat unit, and you've already had Bernadetta around forever for Vengeance by the time that it comes online for him, it is still potential utility nevertheless. I think it leverages the downside of a late joining unit with not great bases, and a special utility that I personally value in training projects really well. It does, of course, help that compared to FE6, Free Houses has more mechanics in order to make this special utility possible. Somehow, an S that I've managed to avoid going into thus far, and who I think would also count as a quote-unquote good S, would be, well, the girl, the myth, the legend, Est herself. As one of the Whitewing sisters, and thus being in a staggering 6 mainline games, Est has a lot of versions just of herself, totaling a grand total of 7 across FEs 1, 2, 3, 11, 12, and 15, counting her FE3 books 1 and 2 versions as separate instances. It's a few. So you'll have to forgive me for choosing to focus on a couple specific examples, those being her iterations from FE3 book 2, later remade into FE12, which plays very differently, and her iterations in both games set in Valentia, Gaiden and Shadows of Valentia. In FE3 book 2, S joins in chapter 15 of an either 20 or 22 chapter game, being imprisoned away from you and your allies with no starting weapons on her person. Due to this, it is very easy for her to not contribute on her join map. The fact that many of the remaining maps in FE3 have indoor or partially indoor sections, and mounts including flyers are required to dismount while indoors, thus incurring a stat penalty, means that it remains difficult for her to meaningfully contribute with her low bases for the time of her joining. To add insult to injury, even if she does gain enough experience in order to be able to gain any levels, she joins right after the chapter where all the star shards get combined into the star sphere if you gathered them all. While she can, of course, equip the star sphere for a flat plus 30% to all growths and benefit from that, what this means is that she isn't able to take advantage of the specific star shards that augment desired specific growths. For example, the Leo shard, which adds 50% to strength growth and subtracts 10% from defense growth, can be equipped in tandem with the Cancer Shard, which subtracts 10% from strength growth and adds 50% to defense growth to give a total of flat plus 40 strength and defense growths. This means that, despite flying being very strong in FE3, even with force dismounting while indoors, she is, frankly, not very good. Nor very interesting as a unit. Her sisters, Pala and Katria, are far, far better than her, having joined much earlier in chapters 3 and 2, respectively, with better bases and having been able to leverage these specific growth-altering star shards. More interesting, I think, are her iterations in both Guidant and Solve, where, while it sounds like a meme, you can use her for her bases because she has good res. This makes her capable of surviving pairs of enemies that her sisters cannot, such as a Javelin Fiend and a Death Cantor in Duma's Gate in Shadows of Valentia, which was mentioned in Mecha's Solve tier list review. Additionally, despite her initial bulk being lacking, the Valentia system of class bases means that Falconite's class bases are guaranteed to salvage it, while Falconite also gives her Banish for an attack boost against monsters, on the route with a lot of monsters. Lastly, more flyers make each other better, especially in the context of Celica route Valentia and with the White Wing sisters being able to triangle attack for huge hit and crit boosts, including being able to activate on enemy phase in Gaiden, which I have experienced great pain because of. It helps that both are strange games, with Shadows of Valentia being a case where quote-unquote efficient grinding is considered to be part of the meta, and both games not having a deployment limit outside of dungeons and endgame. The result, at least in my opinion, is a unit that undeniably has largely bad bases, both in terms of actual stats and then base level, which is important in the class bases system, but that also has niche utility. This, I think, makes her a very interesting iteration of the Est archetype. That, I think, covers a lot of the different forms of Ests, so I will stop detailing them now. Still, a question that nagged me as I continued to look into all the various Ests, though, is the following. Is there even any merit to Ests as an archetype? To be honest, looking through the various candidates, excepting, obviously, the myriad forms of the literal pink-haired Est, I can see little to no meaningful connection between them all. Even without including the discounted examples of Amelia and Ewan from the Sacred Stones, the purported characteristics of low bases, high growths, and late recruitment among Ests are nearly completely inconsistent. Making a spreadsheet for this properly would require either detailed growth comparisons for units across all the games for the relevant units, including the weighting of the key offensive stats of strength slash magic, speed and defense, and is therefore well beyond the scope of this video. Still, an example of each. Regarding the low bases point, as mentioned before, FE6 Hard Mode Zeiss just straight up doesn't have low bases apart from his bad speed. It's definitely true that some of the Ests do have above average growths, like Sophia being on the higher end for FE6, and Nino having the 5th highest growth total behind only Melanus, LOL, Nil slash Ninian, also Lamau, Hector and Lin. Others though, like Tormod, don't actually have better growths compared to some other similar units, like Sorin or Khalil. You run the availability gamut as well, from Toltiu or Sophia being around for about half of their respective games, counting Generation of FE4 as being its own game, to Alencia being around for 4 out of 30 maps. Going beyond that, there isn't even the case that, like the Triangle Attack trio being typically Pegasi, that the Ests share a common class, visual or personality similarities, or even story or character role. This means that if you look at the examples online, you get the eclectic mix of small magical girl Nino, who seems to lack coherent autobiographical memories, mercenary for hire turned mercenary nation founder Jesse, refugee slash sheltered princess Crimea Alincia, actually able to turn into a dragon Kerf Naga, and the actual OG Est, a young, trained Pegasus Knight. This means that in actuality, all that we really have is a late joining unit that has low bases and level for their join time. Which is, if you think about it, just a single example of a base stat slash availability combination that doesn't tell you anything beyond that. Instead, I think that for anything meaningful to come out of the unit archetype definition, there would have to be some clearer unifying factor, such as potential unique utility as I detailed before. Still, examining fully the value of unit archetypes, especially ones that aren't specific in the same way as the Jagan or the Trainee, goes beyond the scope of this video. Supposing that the Est unit archetype is in fact real and a helpful distinction to make, let's move on to the conclusion. Due to their low availability and poor starting stats, in combination with it taking time to train them for an outcome that may not be meaningfully better than other units, if better than them at all, Ests are generally pretty bad units on the whole. The main way in which I think they could stand to be improved is by giving them some unique utility that is either not replicable at all, such as FE9 Tormod's plus 2 move, or at least replicable only by a select few units, such as Dalthea in both Gaiden with Death Warps, or Echoes with Mage Fae. Beyond that, I'm not sure that there needs to be anything else done to improve Ests, or just the general late joiner with low bases as a whole. In a way, the way in which they're defined means that they're inherently bad units, as if the unit's bases get to the point where they're good or solid, as is the case with hard mode FE6 Zeiss, then the question can be posed of whether they're truly an Est at all. Even without these improved bases though, typically there is still a way, even if slow, to train the unit if you really want to for whatever reason. Additionally, while I don't fully understand it, it seems there's something captivating about raising a unit from scratch to get big stat numbers, even if they aren't required, even if they join late, perhaps even especially because they join late. They may not be optimal, and that's fine. Fire Emblem is a series that I love, so while I obviously favour the way in which I like to play the games, I would ultimately like for it to appeal to and be enjoyed by as wide of an audience as possible. If Ests, Trainees, etc. are past that appeal for some fans, then that's a very good thing in the end. Anyway, that's been a cursory analysis of the concept of the Est unit archetype, and some common examples listed. What do you think? Is the Est archetype real? Do you especially like using any of them? I'd love to know your thoughts. I'd also like to point you in the direction of Dapney's simultaneous release video about the Trainee archetype in the description and the end cards, which I have listened to in advance of the video releases and very much enjoyed. Thanks for watching the video, I hope that you enjoyed it. If you did, please do let me know, whether it be through liking or commenting on the video, or subscribing to the channel if you haven't already. If you're interested in my thoughts on any Fire Emblem topic or purported unit archetype, please do let me know as well, which you can do once again either in the comments or by joining the community Discord in the description. Anyway, thanks again, and hope to see you again next time. Until then, have a good one.